Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
It is Tuesday, the 13th day of November, 2012, and I guess the end of the world is in about a month and 10 days. Of course, the media will cut that out of context. I've always said the 2012 garbage is just that garbage. The Mayans didn't even say that. I've gone and studied their prophecies. Not that I put any stock to begin with. But I just thought about, wow, 2012, TikTok, it is long in the tooth, as I like to say. Okay, here is what Mark Fomber, who's been a guest on this show before, and I'm going to pull out all the stops, guys, to call him, to Skype him, to email him, to all the producers, attack. You're on the hunt. Bring us Fomber. I mean, attack in a friendly way, like a red devil squid. You ever seen a red devil squid attack? Amazing footage. Call them the jumbo squid. Side issue, I picture all of us as a swarm of jumbo squid attacking its quarry. They'll actually eat fishermen if they catch them in the water. Side nature issue there. Mark Fomber is saying prepare for a massive market meltdown. Well, this is what I've been saying. As soon as Obama got elected, they would implode the economy so they could hold everyone hostage like they did in 2008. In October, to say, give us unlimited trillions more and give us new taxes, VAT and carbon. And that's now been announced by Bloomberg, you name it. In fact, guys, I've been meaning to do a dissertation on this, and I have mentioned it but not done it properly. A special report on this. I'll do it on the radio today sometime after our guests leave us. Will you print me all the Bloomberg and Reuters articles about the Obama's going to propose a VAT the carbon tax to save us. It's the only way to keep all the welfare going. And hey, half of you are on some form of government assistance. So what do you want? Give us more money. Okay, we'll raise taxes, which is designed to actually implode the economy further because the globalists want to consolidate it and they're exempt. So that is coming up. Obviously, this Petraeus thing is really heating up now. DrudgeReport.com calls it a four-star circus, and it certainly is. That's the image up at DrudgeReport.com. Perhaps we'll punch that up and show the TV viewers. Radio listeners can obviously go there. Also, on DrudgeReport.com, he's linked to our article, Drivers Questioned on Guns at Federal Checkpoint. And this is even worse in hindsight now that I've thought about it, because it turns out they're doing this all over the place where national parks surround major cities, and you've got to go through them to get to Tucson, Arizona, unless you want to go 100 miles out of the way through circuitous routes. So you want to go through the pass. They're there like robbers of old at the pass. Hand them off at the pass! You know, that's where they lie in wait, the highwaymen. Everyone's known that for thousands of years in different cultures. But it's not banditos. It's not desperados. It's not highwaymen. It's government bureaucrats there wanting to search your car and inspect your legal and lawful guns and then order you to do things that are illegal. We're going to be breaking more of that down. And also, gun sales again soaring after Barack Obama's reelection to an all-time turbocharge level. And we've got Larry Pratt joining us of Gun Owners of America via video Skype. And he is going to be joining us in the third hour today. All things Second Amendment and giving you a over the horizon view of how they're going to come after the Second Amendment. And then, boy, they're announcing they are. They're blowing their trumpets. They're banging their war drums. Boom, 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 boom. I mean, it's coming. We can see the campfires and the enemy's letting us know what's up. Dr. Steve Pieczenik, he knows Petraeus. He said that, you know, the whole Benghazi thing was a setup. We'll get his take as well coming up in the second hour. It is going to be one important transmission. Call your friends and family. Tell them tune in today, right now, to Infowars.com and the free audio streams or your local AM and FM stations. There's no doubt that that is happening. We have a corrupt out-of-control globalist bureaucracy where the most corrupt are being promoted to the highest positions of power, and then over time, even more corrupt individuals replace them. It is a system where the most evil, the most cunning, the most manipulative are able to get into control. And that is what we are facing right now. We have seen this cyclical situation over and over again throughout history. Here's what we've got coming up on the transmission today. Consummate State Department Black Ops insider, Dr. Steve Pieczenik. You can just search engine his name, mainstream newspapers, you know, reporting on him running foreign assassination teams, psych warfare operations, hostage rescue negotiations, the Camp David Accords between Egypt and Israel that were successful, the only time they've ever had a peace deal, a lasting peace deal. He was there running psychological operations to get that done. So he is a heavy hitter. I don't completely, obviously, sit here and just absolutely buy everything he says out of hand because it is all cloak and dagger. But he says he's got the scoop on what's really going on with Petraeus. And he also says he has a scoop on Benghazi. Now, that doesn't mean I totally agree with him. Because when I know what's going on with something, I'll tell you. When I still haven't figured out exactly what's going on, I know Obama's lying. I know there's a massive cover-up. I've said that from day one. It's been now proven accurate. Obviously, it was a planned assault. We know that there were missile caches there being shipped into Syria. That's now been confirmed. So day one, we knew more than most people because we studied the situation. But I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, I agree with Pieczenik, and I know he's probably out there listening right now. We're going to debate this coming up. This was a neocon hit to blame Obama. I mean, I could see neocons doing something like that as an October political surprise. The problem is Obama ordered the stand down. They sat around. Now we learned 7 hours. This has all come out. They lied day one and said it was a group of protesters. The CIA torture base down the street was ordered to stand down for 7 hours. Two Navy SEALs assigned to the CIA refused to go along with the orders to stand down and went and fought for hours and got killed. So, but it doesn't mean that I'm saying he's wrong either. I just need to get some of this in perspective from his position. And I know that Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Schaefer, who's been on many times and been proven to be very, very accurate, he says it's a hit on the ambassador, Ambassador Stevens. But he says he doesn't know who did it, what faction in the government, but clearly Obama is lying. So Tarpley says it's a neocon hit or Mormon mafia hit, as he calls it. Which is pretty ridiculous. I mean, just to use the term Mormon Mafia, because the Mormon Mafia is from a group of Mormons hired by a non-Mormon. It's literally, he may have been Mormon. The big CIA guy who was involved in all those different clandestine operations, Howard Hughes. I mean, that's the Mormon Mafia. They were called that because that's who he trusted to handle his affairs and his money. The issue is clearly this is a big scandal. They're calling it the new Watergate. You've got different senators and House members in the news calling for a new Watergate investigation. So we're going to be breaking all of that down and more with Steve Pieczenik. And then we do have Larry Pratt coming on the transmission, head of Gun Owners of America, the second largest Second Amendment group in the country. Who's basically forced the NRA to stop supporting gun control. NRA supported 68 Gun Control Act that's been used against everybody, not just felons, and let the feds get control of our Second Amendment to a great extent. And, of course, crime exploded in the aftermath in the cities where they banned guns, like Chicago and New York. He's going to be able to break down the full flotilla of attacks on our Second Amendment that are coming, not just legislatively through fraudulent law, but by rulemaking. The ATF has promised, if Obama got reelected, to go forward with its rule. You can just type in ATF takes public comments on banning shotguns. All semi-auto shotguns that can take clips or be altered to do it, they're saying they're going to ban outside of a law. And a lot more of that is coming up with Larry Pratt in the third hour today. That said, I have given Obama supporters last Friday and yesterday on the Monday show a chance to call in to tell me why Obama was a good guy. And they say, your guy lost, you're a racist. I'm like, but I really wasn't a supporter of Romney, but his rhetoric was better. The fact that America, at least on the surface, if you believe the electronic voting machines, there's a lot of evidence of fraud, endorsed Romney shows how far gone we are. I agree with Ron Paul's statement, who joined us last Friday, on that issue. We are far gone to a great extent. And so that was my point. And they just showed their utter mindlessness, their political tribalism, just like Republicans would support Bush with torture, secret arrest, open borders, NAFTA GATT expansion, North American Union. They'd say, but he's a Republican, shut up, liberal. And I'd say, I'm not a liberal because I'm against Bush trying to reauthorize the assault weapons ban like he did in 2005. It elapsed in 2004. He tried to get it back in 05, 06, 07, 08, and they introduced the legislation. And I would get hate mail saying I was a darn liar. I've been in a gun shop in McBride's. And the guy said, I don't like you lying about George W. Bush. And then one of the owners said, no, he's right, he did. But the point is, I mean, look, I'm not bad because I defend our republic. I'm not bad because I love this country. I'm not bad because I won't compromise. I'm not bad because I understand both parties are controlled. But mainline Republicans are incredibly tribal, and so are mainline Democrats. And the Democrats take the cake. I mean, it is a new level. I'd say to these callers, so you don't care that 52% of blacks are aborted in this country and that it's a eugenics program. And they're like, no, I don't care. I like it. And then we've got a whole compilation of videos we're going to put on the nightly news tonight with Aaron Dykes of different black people saying, let's get rid of these nappy-headed black kids and statements like that. And it's a real sick culture thing. Evil is increasing everywhere. There is really no doubt about that. So I want to give everybody a chance to call in. First-time callers, though, here today. Obama supporters, people that are upset about Obama being elected, people that think it's great because things are going to get worse a lot faster now. You know, kind of that theory, let the kid have the fever so they break the fever. You know, you have a fever to kill the bacteria, to kill the viruses, to slow down their replication, putting them into that, you know, hotter environment. Is that the idea here? Because we are in trouble either way. It's time to wake up and really realize how much trouble we're in. As they say, wake up and smell the coffee. Well, that is the best time of waking up, I will tell you. It's time to wake up and smell the deep tyranny, and the road we're going down is very bad. Because here's the bottom line, and then I'm going to get into the latest on San Diego residents face 6 years in prison for washing their cars. That's in the local paper. Infowars.com has our own story. This has already started in England. See, it's time to learn how to go to prison. It's time to learn how to be a prisoner of the globalist. And so they want to get everybody into the corrupt system, everybody getting a record. This is how the bureaucracy, how the Agenda 21, how the tyranny by zoning and petty regulation, that's how it works. That's how it operates. And then we're going to get more into drivers questioned at federal checkpoints. Larry Pratt, as I mentioned, petitions to secede are filed for 23 states since election. And in a matter of hours, the Houston Chronicle reports 25,000 Texans, it's like 50,000 by now, it was 40-something thousand this morning, so I'm guessing where it is now. 25,000 Texans in a matter of hours signed the petition for secession, and that's actually in the Constitution, in the federal law. The states created the federal government. So it's the United States, not the states under the federal government. It's self-run by foreign banks, so they're moving in that direction more and more, and you will see more calls for this as the tyranny increases. And when Obama tries to go after the guns, you will see official moves, not to secede, but to annul and use nullification at the state level to block unconstitutional federal activity. And that's why they've been billing and selling the entire time the idea that Obama is Lincoln and that he is going to, you know, shut everybody down, and romanticizing Lincoln and all these movies and fantasy shows and Abraham Lincoln, Vampire Slayer, and Time Magazine and Newsweek, you know, he's the new Lincoln. So we're going to be discussing all of that coming up today as well. And we're also going to be getting into Rupert Murdoch, gleeful at BBC debacle in Britain, the giant pedophile scandal that the police are busy covering up as usual. You know, they're saying that the voice of Elmo has gotten in trouble for having sex with a young boy. That's what's being alleged. And I mean, it's just par for the course. I mean, I got to be honest with you. Watching Sesame Street, just my perv. People say they have gaydar. I don't so much have gaydar. I have pervert dar. And I mean, I'll just be honest. My pervert dar, when I see Hayden, the former head of the NSA, I mean, just pegs. Just pegs. I would walk to the other side of the street if I saw Hayden walking down it. And I got to say, about unless it's guest hosting people, you know, some of the main characters, you know who I'm talking about on there. Just absolutely my pervert radar, my Danger Will Robinson radar goes way off the chart. We'll be right back with the big Petraeus news that could become Obama's Watergate. Straight ahead. We'll be right back. We're back live, ladies and gentlemen. Big John. I am your host, Alex Jones. Again, coming up, Dr. Steve Pieczenik, former State Department head of psychological operations. Larry Pratt, head of Gun Owners of America, also joining us. And before I get briefly into the Petraeus thing, because we'll revisit it more in the next hour and give you what I think is going on there. I mean, we know what's going on to a certain extent. We don't know the whole story or the rest of the story. The media is, of course, playing out a facade for people. But before I do that, let me give the number out, as I was mentioning earlier, since I haven't done that yet, because that's the cue to open the phones up. We're opening the phones right now for first-time callers, whether you love the Obama election, whether you think it's a great thing, a bad thing, and where you see this country going and what you think is going to happen when they try to make you turn in all your semi-automatic rifles and handguns, as they're now announcing they're going to try to do, even outside law. They just say they're going to try to do it, I guess start a civil war. Do you have a take on that? 800-259-9231. You understand we've been infiltrated and taken over by foreign megabanks that use socialism to get the majority of the people on the take, on the dole, so they'll sell out their birthright of freedom for nothing. It's like Cain and Abel, you know. Cain sold out his birthright, half the land, everything. It was a rich family, if you read the Bible, for a bowl of porridge. Came in and he said, I want that bowl of porridge you're sitting there cooking. He said, what do I get? He goes, everything, my birthright. And you know the rest of the story. After they eat the bowl and it's gone, well, they bash our brains out. And then the golden goose is destroyed, but they don't care because, well, they get to dominate and run everything. And people are spray painting King Obama everywhere and getting tattoos saying, Hail Caesar. We've got a whole report on that. And you think it's a joke till you talk to these people. They're like, you lose, I win. It's like moron sports fans. It's one thing if you watch a football game or baseball game or basketball game because it's a diversion. You know it's a diversion. You're getting a little R&R. But when you really get into it and it's your whole life, you're a joke. And it's the same thing with these people who don't have any national pride, any family pride, any cultural pride, any religious pride, any business pride. They just have pride about their sports team. And it's the exact type of looniness I see with these Obama supporters. So I'd like to hear from people on all this. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. I know a lot of people have been chomping at the bit to get on air when I was just letting the Obama people be heard because it was priceless. Just not listening to a word I said, reading teleprompter points that were regurgitated by the media, which they have mental talking points on, just regurgitating the same thing over and over again, saying, aha, your guy lost. And I'm like, no. They own both guys, but they wanted this guy. Can't you get that? Just elementary stuff. And it's like, I feel good. My guy won. You lost. And you've seen the cover just invoking incredible racial division. That's what the left does. This is how they control people. They have a stake in it. The Democratic Party of the Ku Klux Klan. Literally, look into it. It says if you're white, you're history. I mean, this is the type of incredible garbage, the Obama conquest. How about it should say the New World Order conquest, the banker conquest? Well, you know, when you read the Financial Times of London or even Time Magazine or Newsweek and previous articles, they say the Bank of the World has conquered us. That's the popular quote. And then I can play the news clips of them bragging on CNBC, CNN. I can show you countless headlines. The first issue of our magazine, InfoWars Magazine, we had just dozens of quotes and links to the news. What was the headline on that article? It was in the magazine. We also then posted it after the magazine came out at InfoWars.com. The other article was Rome Burned, Will We? But the other big one was bankers declare they've conquered Europe and the U.S. And then we had their quotes. Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, just talking about how stupid we are. And all of this. Wow, this is a first. My son is now in the control room, punching buttons, talking to me over the microphone. He's chomping at the bit, begging every day to get on air. We're very close to one of my progeny being on air, out of the control room. That's right, and jumping the gun on my own show here. My point is, hearing that Obama quote about, you didn't build that business, somebody else did that. What's going to happen is that this has happened in hundreds of other countries. There's over 170 countries. More than half of them in the last 100 years or so have been socialist or communist at one time. And it follows an exact pattern. And it is nightmarish. Now, I want to get in briefly into the Petraeus news as a prelude to what's coming up in the next hour. And then go to your phone calls at 800-259-9231. My son, who's 10 years old... and I'm not just saying this because he's my son. I will put him on air soon. He's going to be part of the news team here because he keeps begging to do it. And because if I was reading history books and things when I was 10, but I wasn't half as informed as he already is. And I always conflate stories. When it's news and information, I almost always get it right. I make some mistakes. We correct it when I do. Sometimes I'm thinking about something else, and I say, yeah, they've already shipped General Motors over to China. Now they're shipping Jeep. I tell you, that's what you get bailing out General Motors, where it sounded like I was saying Jeep was General Motors and not Chrysler. I know that it's Chrysler. My dad drives a Jeep Sahara. I'm a fan of Jeep, and I knew that, but I heard the rebroadcast later, and it was wrong. So occasionally, the type of mistakes I make are blaring. And I was conflating the story of Cain and Abel, where one brother killed the other. And my son was smart enough. He wasn't on the on-air mic, though, was he? He was on the conference mic where you guys talked to me. He was on the conference mic, correct? Thumbs up? Yeah, he comes in and pops in my ear and says, Dad, you're wrong about Cain and Abel. And I'm like, ho, hold your horses. So I walk out. He tells me how I'm wrong during the break. We pull it up on the online Bible resources, and he's correct. Been a long time since I was in Sunday school. It's Jacob and Esau. So, son, I'm not going to say your name yet. I'm not ready to destroy your innocence yet and throw you into the shark pit. But we're, you know, no guts, no glory. Fortune favors the bold, and our fortune is liberty that we're looking for. So you want in the shark tank. I was going to put him in the shark tank a few months ago here on the air because he really wants to do it. And my wife is like, no, not yet. But I think she's ready to pull the trigger. So mama has got to pull the trigger. So don't say your name. Let's put him on air. He can correct me. This guy has written, this is no exaggeration. Started reading children's Bibles when he was 5. He now reads adult King James versions. And because he loves it, it's a great history book. And he reads many other history books. But here I'm bragging on my son, and then I'll get into the news and your calls. But son, you can now correct me live on air. Go ahead.
Well, Dad, if you look at the Bible, you got it right that they do get into a big fight, but his mom gets him out of there before Esau can bash his brains out. And also, you got it right about the soup. It's you just got their names wrong. I'm sorry about interrupting the show.
No, you didn't. Listen, the guys all the time hear me make mistakes, and they don't correct me. And I've asked them, at least when I go to break, to correct me, because when they kind of shout corrections at me, then I'm not quite picking up what they're saying half the time, probably because I'm half deaf. But thank you so much for that. Tell us about the story of the brother that sold his birthright, and then how I conflated. That means kind of like you take two sides of the card deck and put them in together. I know you know what conflate means. What's the story of Cain and Abel then? I know one brother killed the other. What was that fight over? That was over the soup, wasn't it? Or was that the other guys?
It was over actually a sacrifice to God, because God was pleased with Abel's sacrifice because it was a flesh and blood sacrifice, and not Cain's sacrifice because it was actually a fruit and vegetable sacrifice. You see, Cain was a farmer and Abel was a shepherd.
By the way, Wes in there is a big Bible guy, goes to church multiple times a week, reads the Bible with his children every day, and he's in there nodding his head. So see, this is not scripted. I mean, the crew's here, they saw my son just came, knew how to hit the button and talk to me on air, I guess from watching, took over the show, and now during the break I said, well, go ahead and officially come on the air then and correct us. So that's the Cain and Abel story. What's the other story that I mixed with the Cain and Abel story?
You see, Esau was the oldest brother by like a few seconds. He came out, they were actually twins. Jacob and Esau were twins. He came out first, so he got the double portion of his father's wealth.
Wasn't the other one holding on to the other guy's foot? Or was that the twins that Abraham had? They were fraternal twins, right? And then it made the two nations. No, that was the kid that came later. See, my problem is I got to revisit the Bible because I know this news stuff, but now when it comes to the Bible, it's all just mixed together.
Okay, so can I continue the story now?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. They grew up, Esau was like the best in the tribe at hunting, and he was his father's favorite. But Jacob was his mother's favorite. He was so quiet. He would stir the soup. He would cook.
No. Keep going.
It just got cut out for a minute. And so this sort of caused the dynamic between the brothers where Jacob was really jealous of Esau. And one night, Esau had come home from hunting. He had a big deer. He didn't have any deer.
And he was hungry.
Yeah, and he was hungry, and he saw Jacob stirring soup, and Jacob was very clever, while his brother was very pretty much stupid. And he tricked Esau into trading the soup for his birthright.
All right. Well, thank you so much for that story. Again, this is unscripted, and you've done a great job. Guys, you see why he's going to do so good on air? I mean, first time, boom, correcting Alex Jones on air. And but hey, with great power comes great responsibility. Remember that. I love you. That's anything else you'd like to add? Listen to Madondi out there. Go ahead.
Oh, just thank you for letting me be on the air for the first time. I really hope it turns out to be a good thing for me. And I'm nervous.
All right, I love you, son. Oh, man, I'm nervous, too.
Bye.
Bye, I love you. Okay, no more jumping on the microphone. Oh, man. Okay, there you go. So he corrected me. I was conflating those two stories. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Maybe we can have Bible time with my son. I keep wanting to say his name. I'm not going to say his name yet on air because you know what the enemy will do. All right, continuing here, ladies and gentlemen, we have a lot of other news that I want to get to, but I do want to get to your phone calls. On the Petraeus front, let me just read you some of the headlines here. Petraeus investigation ensnares commander of U.S. NATO troops in Afghanistan. And it was a couple other generals in the last month, the one over AFRICOM, has had to be relieved from his overall command. It's all about Benghazi. It's a huge purge. They wanted Petraeus to testify this week. Magically, all this happens. I mean, does anybody buy this? Exclusive. Paula Broadwell's emails revealed. This is a four-star circus, as Matt Drudge says. And they're not threatening. So why was the FBI tapping Petraeus's computer? This is just their cover so they can say... And then you've got this woman on the base who's unpaid, part of social help. Yes. who just so happened to be contacting the FBI guy who's sending her images of his shirt off. I mean, all of this, that's just their excuse to claim of why they were surveilling him, and they've now raided Broadwell's home. Was Broadwell a spy for a foreign government? I don't know. I mean, you know, is Obama engaged in damage control? Is this a blackmail operation? We now know that the young lady Clinton was sharing cigars with, Monica Lewinsky. Who knows? FBI agent sent topless pictures of himself to Petraeus whistleblower after becoming obsessed with her. And now he's been banned from the investigation. So that's a way to shut down an FBI guy who they're setting up as well. See, they'll burn everybody involved in the cover-up. I mean, this is big. And here's this woman, Jill Kelly, the whistleblower. Oh, yes. Who was unpaid on the base, just part of a social support group, yes. Just like Broadwell, I'm sure. Continuing, Petraeus affair, part of criminal probe. Again, FBI, they're having to raid everyone. Paula Broadwell's father, this is about something else entirely, and the truth will come out. Gee, think so? Think it's about a honeypot, maybe? You know what that is? It's the number one level of intelligence operations, to use women on men and Casanova types on women, or men on men, women on women. That's how they control these people. And the people knowingly get involved in it because you're always compromised at those levels. It's so they can just destroy you whenever they want, and you know it. You know, I used an example of this yesterday, and CJ said most people probably didn't get it. They probably haven't seen Dune, the movie, which is a shadow of the incredible book by Frank Herbert, that if you know politics and the Illuminati and the New World Order, that guy was definitely an insider of some type. I don't want to get Frank Herbert's son on sometime, if you can do that. But the point is, he's a good writer too, but nothing compared to his dad, I got to be honest. You know, it's like more like Pulp Fiction. I guess they're just churning them out. I guess his dad churned out some too. But the point is, that one book, you know, on how intrigue and conspiracies operate, Baron Harkonnen has these heart plugs, and that's in the movie. It's actually not in the book. Where if he's upset with you, you just don't worry. Everyone gets a heart plug. They just pull them out, and then, you know, it opens up a port to your heart, and blood gouts out, and Baron Harkonnen likes it splattering on him. It's actually based on what a lot of the British royalty and people are into, if you actually look at the history of it. Of course, they are Transylvanian lineage to Dracul. Vlad the Impaler, or Count Dracula, Count Dragon, little red dragon symbol of England. That's the Illuminati symbol of England. The lion rampant is the symbol they don't particularly like, but it's the old symbol of England. But I now digress here, expanding on all this lore. How did I get off into that? These people know they're compromised, that you have to go be compromised to be sent up the ladder of ascension into the New World Order barony of being a high-level minion. You know, the real power structure, you never hear about them. And again, Judge Napolitano's asking, what were FBI agents doing monitoring Petraeus' private emails? The CIA director has the FBI spying on him over a girlfriend that sent stuff saying, I'm watching you, and you better watch it, hussy. You know, running around here on the base is basically what she said. Oh, my gosh, let's spy on the CIA director. I mean, the Congress is told when it wants to know about what the CIA director is doing that it's above their security clearance, when Congress funds the CIA and everything else and is the highest level, even above the president. So things have gotten totally backwards, but we're to believe the FBI was spying on the CIA director. I mean, does anyone buy this? Does anyone buy that we have seen 7-hour stand down in Benghazi up from 5 hours, a CIA torture base down the street, and no help rendered? There is a cover-up here. There's a cover-up. Obama has lied. The question is, what's really going on here? So we're going to be looking at that more coming up. And now more commanders. The investigation scares commander of U.S. NATO troops in Afghanistan. Turns out the FBI has 30,000 pages of documents with all of their camp followers. And again, the military has totally degenerated at the top. The regular troops are having their pension funds stolen. They're having their death benefits they paid into, that's their money, stolen. That's on record. That's not even a news item. It's just back of the paper. They're using DU. They're getting sick. They're having experimental vaccines tested on them. They're serving 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 tours that no one would ever think of. They're committing suicide at record numbers, 7 times the previous record. And the generals have brand new jet aircraft with lavish, you know, marble, champagne, all the women on board. It's like an orgy. This has come out in the news. They're on there with, you know, having orgies, basically. And the troops are in C-130s with the cushions all rotted out, with mites everywhere and toilets overflowing, defecating in buckets. Remember that came out 3 years ago? I mean, on those troops' transports, they're defecating in buckets. There's mites everywhere. It's total filth. The aircraft are rattling apart. You think I'm joking? Go look it up. It was in the news a couple of years ago. You remember that? Just type in military transports falling apart. You know, troops using buckets. Meanwhile, the generals are champagne with, I mean, this bumbling woman is on the news gushing about Petraeus, obviously. I mean, it's just so ridiculous. And I was thinking about it this morning, and then I'm going to go to your calls. I'm going to go to your calls now because I said I'd go to them. We're running out of time here. Andy in Indiana, you're on the air. Are you celebrating Obama right now?
Absolutely not, Alex. I actually called today because have you heard about this explosion in Indianapolis?
Yeah, they were popping in my ear telling me they had the Napolitano video. I didn't hear what you said. Go ahead.
Oh, I said, have you heard about this explosion in Indianapolis?
No. We'll have to track and scan the news here as a news organization. Let me tell me about that.
Well, the news is just saying it was a faulty furnace, and the house that it was in was completely leveled.
Well, that happens. I mean, sir, they have gas mains blow up. They have all sorts of stuff happen all the time. Did you see that power plant explosion in New York? We never even showed that. That was more important news, but it was amazing. First it lights on fire, and then the big transformer blows up.
Well, the part that concerns me is that the whole area, I'm not sure who's heading it, but they're not letting people leave or go in to the whole area of the explosion.
Yeah, well, that's usually a sign of a cover-up if they're not letting you leave. They weren't letting you come in. That's understandable. Yeah, 2 dead from that, sir. I appreciate your call. Thanks for giving us a tip on that. Scott in South Carolina. Scott, you're on the air. Are you celebrating Lord Obama? Go ahead, Scott, if you want to be on air. We'll talk to you right now, buddy. Okay.
No, I'm not.
You're not happy.
I'm out of there.
Yeah, you're on the air, bro. We're going to try this one more time. Go ahead.
All right, cool. No, I am not following this drone over here. What's the topic? I kind of just missed the last 5 minutes. I apologize.
Hey, I appreciate your call, bro. No. Listen, I really appreciate your call. Here's what happens. When we don't screen calls, sometimes we get really great calls. Sometimes we get the worst in talk radio. Because I have this thing of not screening your calls because all their talk radio does it. And a lot of talk radio uses it to get the views they want on air. But, I mean, my big thing is I give the number out and people call in and say, I don't know what we're talking about today. Or they sound drunk. But when I say I want police to call in or military or school teachers or people on certain topics, it's incredible calls. Or when I say folks from Australia or folks from Mexico call in, tell us what you're seeing with the flu outbreak. Incredible groundbreaking calls. So I guess we're going to have to start screening calls just by the topic. So we won't screen you calling in, but it's got to be on the topic. This time I said, are you celebrating the Obama election? And no one is calling in about what I said. I mean, I said what the topic was. Let's try these phone calls again. First-time callers, I want your take on the state of the world, where you see the economy going. Mark Faber, top economist researcher, right up there with Jim Rogers, says prepare for a massive market meltdown. Well, yeah, staged just like 08 to hold everyone hostage. Max Kaiser predicted it. I predicted it. Gerald Celente predicted it. Bob Chapman, before he died, predicted it. Because they do the same tricks. They do it in the third world. They did it here in 08. We're going to be talking about that coming up as well. But they're going to hold everybody hostage and say, oh, we got to raise carbon taxes, VAT to pay so that all the welfare queens get their money. And really, it's going to go to banker bailouts, but the welfare queens will say, yeah, I deserve some more money. And it's all short term. They have short term thinking. That's why they're poor. That's why they're broke. That's why they're domesticated. And they're going to come rob those of us, the producers, even more. It's the poor, welfare class with the ultra elite, pressure from above, pressure from below. God help us. God help us. Martha in Hawaii, welcome to the airwaves. Thank you for calling.
I'm a first-time caller. I've had many experiences that are bad. First of all, I'm a black woman, and I have had so many problems with my family and my friends, black, white, Latino. All my friends think I'm insane for what I've been trying to show them and tell them. I've had the most terrible experiences with TSA. The woman went completely into my vagina this last time. It was just horrible.
It's a total act of domination. Listen, if they admit for 3 years they go in the pants and in women. And I don't like to talk like this on air, folks. This is what happens in America. It's why I cannot fly, because now they will demand to grab your children, even if you say no and want to leave now, and drag them to the pervert assault room. And I'm sorry, ma'am. Go ahead.
No, but I'm the most unthreatening person in the world. I'm from the old school. I dress nicely.
Ma'am, it's not about that you're non-threatening. It's an act of domination and enslavement. We're being inducted back into slavery, that we have no dignity, that we have... that's why the globalists try to push that we have no dignity. Exactly. You say you're from the old school, when Hispanics, blacks, whites, everybody, even the poorest people, did everything they could to walk upright, to dress nice, and to have dignity. They've taken our dignity with the MTV culture so that now we can have our dignity destroyed. The first step of slavery is destroying your dignity, and that's what the TSA is the front line of. Ma'am, go ahead.
The NDAA was the final straw. We are relocating. I've been studying where to go in the world, but we're waiting for our book for the relocation. It's going to take 4 to 6 weeks. I ordered it the moment you said it was available, so I've been waiting for it to come. But the worst part about it is this race thing. They're trying to divide us that way. That is the most horrible thing in the world. That's really getting me. And the things that are going on here on the island, we have these people with these big black cards stopping us already here on the island. It's going on here.
Oh, yeah. There are now federal police all over the country just setting up checkpoints, searching vehicles from Tennessee to Arizona in the middle of the country. And sometimes they have army there or Marines with heavy machine guns on the news aiming them at your cars. And they'll have police just set up a checkpoint and just aim M16s at families. It's on the news. And I mean, let me tell you something. I'm driving along and I'm pulling up. It's one thing if the car matches a description, it looks like it, and they're saying, get out of the car. No, they aim them at everybody as an act of domination. And let me tell you, I'm going to get upset by that. I mean, look, it's going to be just like 1776. They're going to push, and they're going to push, and they're going to push, because they're a bunch of delusional perverts. If they're not up there with a bunch of whores on board the jet aircraft, the military, at least the military is with women. I mean, most of these politicians are in there literally raping little kids. We're dealing with a cult of gang rapers. Gee, it's an intelligence operation to infiltrate and set up these men. General who sent thousands of inappropriate emails to woman who reported harassment by Petraeus' mistress. You got the FBI spying on the CIA director? Give me a break, ladies and gentlemen. That's off the charts. We're going to be breaking that down with Dr. Steve Pieczenik coming up, getting his take on what's really going on. He personally knows Petraeus, goes to the CFR and called out General Dempsey. He said there wouldn't be an Iran attack because the Joint Chiefs had told Israel there wouldn't be. I respect what he has to say, but we're going to try to flesh it all out coming up. This is going to be some pretty powerful radio. Gary in New York, you're on the air. Thanks for holding, sir. Are you celebrating Obama's victory?
No, sir. No, I'm not. I'm a true patriot. First off, God bless you and your staff. I appreciate all you guys do.
Thank you.
You know, I was thinking maybe this, before I get on my Obamunoid pushing Obamunism statement, possibly this Petraeus thing could be a blessing in disguise. Maybe, I'll start some things up, possibly get Obama maybe in some trouble.
Well, my gut is, this is what they did with Nixon and others. When somebody goes into a second term, they're dangerous to even the establishment because they're not facing re-election. And if a president ever tried to actually act like a president and not just a total puppet, they have to assassinate him. But they don't like that either because people won't buy that anymore, like Kennedy. So instead, what they do is they destroy it with a scandal. But they don't like scandals that deal with corporate corruption. So they usually get you with a sex scandal, like Clinton and Monica Lewinsky. And again, I was no fan of Bill Clinton, but that was all part and parcel of that. The Republicans wouldn't go after him, you know, for the missile secrets of Laura Allen Hughes, the communist Chinese, or the death of Commerce Secretary Ron Brown. They went after him on a sex thing because that's isolated to just that. And that's probably what's going to end up happening here. I think it's a balance of power thing that's happening. But again, we know this is a big scandal. We know it's bigger than what they're saying. We know it's an intelligence operation. We know they knew about Benghazi. We know they lied about it. The question is, who's behind it? What are the real players? What's the outcome going to be? I don't think we really know that yet. You can speculate, but I want proof. Go ahead and make your other point, sir.
Well, real quick, it's just ironic that, you know, Hillary Clinton is going away. Petraeus isn't going to testify. It's just really shady. And that, on top of all the executive orders Obama passed in his first 4 years, should have been frightening enough. And that gets me into my point.
But he gave us a phone. He's going to do more. I'm sorry.
Oh, it's crazy. And you know, you got people like that idiot Eric from New York calling up yesterday. You know, the thing that disgusts me the most is it seems like the globalist double standard is trickled down to the dumbed down masses. I mean,
oh no, guys, they think it's good to kill other people so they have more room in there, but they don't understand they're being killed too. Is that what you were going to say?
Yeah, well, you know, it doesn't make sense that the average person, I mean, your son is more intelligent than 90% of the people in this country. And, you know, these guys, they could kill, we go to jail. They could sell drugs, we go to jail. They could push away vaccines, we push away vaccines on our kids. They have CPS come snatch up our children. You know, and it's trickled down to the people. And you have, you know, I live in the Bronx. Unfortunately, it's bittersweet. I understand it's a police city state. I understand that. But I'm Italian. I got a lot of people who are African-American. They're not dumbed down and ignorant. And people forget, when Planned Parenthood was created, they used people who were the black faces of the society movements and used them to push their eugenics on the black society. And yet you have all these people, if you're white and you didn't vote for Obama, you vote for a white guy, you're racist.
No, that's what's crazy is that I'm like, hey, they're killing half the black people in abortions. And the guy's like, I don't care. I love it. You're racist. And I'm like, so, I mean, I'm telling you, man, it's sick because I'm telling you, I've been around those type of people. We got a bunch of video clips of it. We're going to air it soon where there's black folks saying, yeah, kill the little nappy head black kids because it's this idea of kill somebody, I'll get more. It's amazing. Monday through Friday from 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern, we are here live, and it is now the 13th day of November 2012. We are seeing massive geopolitical movements worldwide. We are seeing incredible movements inside the military-industrial complex. What you're seeing from my perspective, we'll get Dr. Pieczenik's take on this, is soft power coups going on back and forth. You have the FBI on record, and even Judge Andrew Napolitano is saying this is clearly illegal, unconstitutional, spying on the CIA director without warrants because another woman who was involved in the hospitality, a volunteer at the Special Forces command bases, she was a volunteer. They're helping the men in social services. She was a social volunteer. What a nice lady. And you've got the head of the Afghanistan operations sending her thousands of inappropriate, according to the Associated Press, emails. DrudgeReport.com has it all, calling it a four-star circus. Infowars.com has it all as well. So does PrisonPlanet.com. We're streaming video right now for radio listeners if they like to watch at InfowarsNews.com. So you can see all these articles and documents and photos that we're talking about. But I remember just a few days after the Benghazi situation, we had Dr. Steve Pieczenik on, who is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. He confronted a few months ago the Joint Chiefs of Staff Chairman Dempsey at the CFR and said, you know, that he needed to go public and say, don't attack Iran. That later even came out in the news months after he talked about it. And to his credit, Dempsey went public and said it's a suicide mission. Just as many as the Israelis are saying it's going to be a catastrophe, including the former Mossad chief. Instead of using soft power against Iran, some want to go to this larger regional war that will probably lead to a third world war, at least a conventional world war. And you saw Benghazi. We know it didn't go 5 hours, it went 7 hours. We know there's been a cover-up. We know it was an orchestrated attack. Why did the White House come out and say it wasn't an orchestrated attack? Then Dr. Pieczenik said it was a neocon internal government operation as a false flag October surprise to knock out Obama. He's been critical of Obama, saying the bin Laden story was a hoax. He said it 10 years ago on my show. He said it right after it happened. Then that started to come out. Stratford responded. The mainstream media responded and said that a lot of the intelligence community weren't buying it. So this became a big international story, but also within internal intelligence, it became really big. And Dr. Pieczenik was approached by different spy agencies, Mossad, CIA, you name it. I was approached off record and asked to shut up. I have not shut up. I have been threatened as well. So, you know, at a certain point, even though I researched this stuff, no exaggeration, 18 hours a day and even dream about it, because once you get obsessed with something and you've got a decent brain, the world opens up. I'm not sure what's going on. I know there's a cover-up. I know it was an attempted false flag at some level. I know there were missiles at that facility, the thousands that are missing, to be shipped into Syria. That's now come out. We said that a month ago. Dr. Tarpley and others did. We know that the ambassador was starting to become critical of what was happening. That's since been confirmed. Pieczenik said that. So that backs up some of what he's saying. But I don't get, and we're going to walk through this here today, I wanted to give us the big picture first and simplify it, then get into more details. I don't get if it's some type of internal false flag, October surprise against Obama, because certain power structures wanted in, you know, to control the military-industrial complex trough and wanted a hot war against Iran. Why Obama stood down? Why he lied about it? Why he gave the press conferences? Why the U.S. ambassador to the UN, Rice, said on all the different news shows that Sunday after it happened, the day after, that it was just a protest gone wrong. Why the cover-up if it was a black op against him? Okay, and now, why are they purging Petraeus? Why are they purging the head of AFRICOM? Why are they purging who was over Benghazi? Why are they purging the head of the Afghanistan operation? This is all happening, all connected to this one woman. Is this woman a operative? Is this woman what they call a honeypot? That's a question we're going to ask. And Dr. Pieczenik, again, is an MD, PhD, an American psychiatrist, trained and served under Kissinger, former State Department official, author, and publisher. He, of course, has written many, co-written many of the Tom Clancy books. It had been turned into major movies and TV shows and series. He's a critically acclaimed author of psychopolitical thrillers and co-creator of the best-selling Tom Clancy's Ops Center and NetForce, just to name a few. Trained in psychiatry at Harvard University, international relations at the same time. Only got to have 2 degrees at the same time. MIT. His novels are based on over 20 years' experience resolving international crises and hostage situations for the Department of State for four administrations, stevepieczenik.com. Notice he's revamped and upgraded his site. Looks really good. And, of course, if you really look up his name, he's been involved in overthrows of governments using psych warfare to get people to kill. You never talk about this on air, but the London Telegraph, you can correct me if I'm wrong, says that he tricked the communists into killing the Italian prime minister, things like that. So he's a serious guy. He joins us now. Sure, I know I've thrown a lot out there. That's what I do, so everybody kind of gets some of the pieces. I want to start with the big picture. You said that there were internal jockeying and things going on. I'd like to start with Petraeus and what's happening now, lead that into Benghazi, lead that into bin Laden, and what the power structure is doing right now with the internal tectonic fissures. Dr. Pieczenik, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Alex, for having me on the show. Let me start with number one. Basically, what Petraeus is doing what all generals have done previously, is to basically fall on the sword of immolation, basically take himself out, because he probably did not agree with the decisions of General Dempsey, Panetta, and what I call the choir boys, the people who are Donlan, Brannon, and the president himself. What this really is a internal fight between what is the military culture, which was rising and something I encouraged, against the civilian culture, which was really dominated by the CIA, antiquated TIA, and it's been a power structure fight for a very, very long time, over 20 years, probably starting with back to the Bush Sr., going through the Clinton administration, where you had two different types of cultures trying to dominate our foreign policy. And it was much more Machiavellian than anybody realized. It was behind the scenes. What you have is a CIA that's really dysfunctional, that is consisting of people who have never really been able to acclimate to the new world, to a world which has become more electronic, more precise, more incisive. And what happened is you have a lot of men who were in the 70s and 80s. Many of them were alcoholics who I treated. Many of them came out of the Catholic religion. I have nothing against Catholicism. People like Dempsey, who was the chairman of Joint Chiefs of Staff, Brannon, Donilon, all of whom really were not very qualified to run anything other than a series of past failures. I'll give you an example. Brannon, who's now the counterterrorism head, was in charge of the towers that blew up in Saudi Arabia. He's a totally incompetent station chief who's been an advisor to not only Clinton, but went through Bush Jr., was involved in 9/11, the original 9/11, and has created a total series of false narratives that the CIA has been very not effective in doing, including the 9/11 Osama bin Laden story, the Osama bin Laden raid, which was false. And now it finally came to the confrontation of Benghazi. Benghazi is really the trigger point of the entire conflict between our U.S. military, which is a highly trained, very precise organization, which would not tolerate the ad hoc or the kind of willy-nilly efforts of the CIA to create all kinds of conflicts, and the incompetence of our civilian government, including Obama, including Hillary Clinton, who has had a history of men who have died all along her side, who've allowed men to die. Remember Foster? She herself has been a very disastrous figure in our foreign policy, going all the way back to Bill Clinton, when she encouraged him not to get involved in the killing and the massacre of 800,000 people in Rwanda. Nobody knows about
that. Sure, Doc. Listen, I'm going to give you the floor to get into all this, but just for listeners tuning in right now, I understand some of the background. You're talking to people out there in government, not just the audience, But, I mean, come on, you've got the same woman connected to all these generals. You've got
Forget about the woman, Alex. What I want you to remember, all of this is what we call a cover story and a honey trap that doesn't really exist. Whatever the story is, we're talking about characters now. We're the real bigger picture. You've got to pull back, Alex, for a minute. The real picture now is what happens when you have a military that was led by Petraeus taking over the CIA and saying that you're going to have to now not work a loosey-goosey and out of control as you've been doing it for 20, 30 years, but you're going to be a militarized service. And so what happened, a lot of the CIA is no longer what we have civilian. We have really outsourced special forces who have been on contract. So basically our entire covert operations institution has been contract officers who make a lot of money, 250,000 ex-special forces, and we have the military, who's been standing by and being told what to do and to go into areas that they don't want to create wars, for example, in Libya. There was no reason whatsoever to take down Gaddafi, absolutely no reason. There was no reason whatsoever to go into Libya, into Syria, to take down Syria.
And a lot so now it's purely about the payday, and if they continue this, even if there's a corrupt power structure, there's not going to be an America left if these mercenaries continue to get in the way of the real national goals and national interests of this nation.
That's correct. The mercenaries was a problem that was brought up to me by the general, Special Forces general 10 years ago, when he asked me, who do I think would be the next major enemies of the United States, and I said the mercenaries that we're creating.
Okay, Doc, we got to go to break. Humor me when we come back and recap what you're really saying happened in Benghazi, and then let's get into what's happening with Petraeus, because clearly the FBI and the Justice Department is now spying on generals without warrants. This is some type of internal battle coup operation. I want you to put it in layman's terms. Talk to me like I'm 6 years old, Doc. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Okay, Dr. Steve Pieczenik is our guest. This is a short segment, long segment coming up. I just want to revisit this because you were on a month or so ago. You said that it was a Israeli neocon coup, from the information you had, against the Obama administration, who you've been critical of, but you were saying there were all these internal power structure coups. I'd like to hear the evidence of that. Now in the aftermath, why would Obama then try to cover up? Why wouldn't he send aid? There was a CIA torture base right down the street. Why is all this going on, and how does it tie into five generals now in the last month? The head of AFRICOM, the head of the Afghan operation, now Petraeus and one other. I guess Petraeus was the head of, was he the head of CENTCOM? I mean, this is getting really, really crazy. And obviously, there's seismic, you know, the ground is rumbling in Washington, and we're being told it's about these women. I know that's a distraction. I know that's the cover story. I get that. But I'm saying, what's deeper, Dr. Pieczenik? So let's start at Benghazi, please, sir.
All right. The Benghazi issue was a totally illegal operation, which was signed off by the President of the United States, who, remember, is part of the CIA. His mother was CIA. His grandfather was CIA. He was trained in the CIA. What you have here is the CIA versus the military conflict going on, and you have basically an out-of-control foreign policy that's run by mercenaries and by a military that refuses to engage in civilian intrusions into Libya and Syria. And what happened in Benghazi was that the ambassador was clearly murdered under the directions of Hillary Clinton, who has had a history of allowing people to die and men to die. So the consulate was really used as a center for, as I said before, RPGs for torture. Now, they had the mercenaries, the SEALs, had several Libyan and other foreigners in the embassy, in the consulate, which was used to torture these victims. And basically, this was a totally illegal operation, which did have a finding. When I say it's illegal, it means that it's illegal by the International Court of Law. It's illegal by using an embassy or consulate. It's an illegal usage. So what you have here is military fighting the CIA, basically, and the military coup that was beginning to say, we no longer want to find, we don't want to listen to the President of the United States. We're tired of listening to the Bushes. We're tired of listening to Obamas. We're tired of listening to Panetta, who really had no credibility. And we were tired of listening to Dempsey, who I had warned a month before, as I told you, the Council on Foreign Relations. Would you ever stand up to the President of the United States? And in his lilting Irish kind of leprechaun evasiveness, he gave me such bullshit. I would have fired him then and there. But the real issue was that General Hamm, the rear admiral in charge of a carrier task force, were watching their own men being killed in a place where illegally the operation was not legal, but nevertheless, these were their soldiers, their special forces. And all over the world, we could monitor this for 8 hours.
And you said this a month ago. They had two drones over. So why don't the generals come out and say, you made us stand down and go public? Because if what you're saying is right, and I agree that's where this is pointing, then they're going to end up killing these guys before they can come out and blow the whistle.
Let me tell you, Alex, why. Because we have created, and this is why it's important for our public to understand, and I've said it for a long time, we have created a general corps that is not consistent with what we had in World War II, when we had a George Marshall who would fire 600 generals in minutes and in hours because they would not stand forth. And instead of standing down, they should have never stood down. Ham should never have stood down. The rear admiral should never have stood down. None of them should have stood down, because the SEAL teams that were in there, and the special forces that were in there, were told that they would have overhead cover when they marked the entire consulate to say, look, we have to blow this up. And instead, what we've had is a military which has wanted to assert power has backed down because of several reasons. Number one, America has to understand our military now is a non-functional military. It is filled with generals who have never really been in war, who have really concerned about getting more medals and more positions, but have never asserted their aggressiveness or their warlike attitudes, which they should have. And basically, they're making $3 million when they leave the government and they go on to go to L3.
So okay, break it down. This is riveting, and it makes sense, and you did call it early on.
I'm saying our military has been dysfunctional for the past 20 to 30 years. However, we developed a small core of generals whom I've worked with, whether it was Petraeus or others.
Okay, stay there, Doc. We got to go to break. Satellites cutting in. Here we go. I am Alex Jones, waging war on corruption, crashing through the lies and disinformation. I have traveled around the world, and I'm telling you, the United States is one of the best places to live, and my ancestors have been here on the Mayflower, and even longer. I'm part Native American, and I don't want to see my republic go into a complete tyranny. And we are all in grave danger. We're going to talk about what this means, that there's obviously a giant battle between the intelligence agencies, the FBI, and the Defense Department. That's undoubted. General sent thousands of inappropriate emails to woman who reported harassment by Petraeus' mistress. FBI agent banned from probe after he grew obsessed and sent her shirtless photos. Bombshell story is just a smokescreen for something bigger. That's what the father of Petraeus' biographer girlfriend has said. And he says it's about to come out. Local TV station mistakenly airs altered sexually suggestive version of Broadwell's book cover. This is a big battle inside government. They're talking about impeachment of Obama. They're talking about this being the new Watergate. We're going to cover it with Dr. Steve Pieczenik of stevepieczenik.com, high-level former intelligence operator, head of psych warfare for the State Department, worked on peace deals with, of course, Egypt and Israel successfully there at Camp David. He is, you know, giving us his inside scoop, member of the Council on Foreign Relations, on what's happening. We're going back to him to give him the floor here in one moment to go out of Benghazi to the battle that's happening, where he sees it going, and why the generals didn't come out with this. Because it's now confirmed the military sat there and watched. That's been confirmed. Colonel Schaefer agrees with a lot of what Pieczenik's saying. He says it was a hit, a murder. He just says, you know, it looks like some elements want missiles to get to Al-Qaeda because that's good for military business. That's basically what Pieczenik's saying. This is about arming Al-Qaeda for the next stage. Will that be terror attacks here used to take our liberties? We'll talk to Dr. Pieczenik in a moment. First off, we are listener-supported. When you support our local AM and FM stations by supporting their sponsors or becoming a sponsor, whether you're listening to us in Tampa, Florida, or Chicago, Illinois, Austin, Texas, or Rochester, New York, it is so important, whether you're listening in Oregon or New Mexico, to spread the word about those local AM and FM stations and support the local sponsors or become a sponsor. The show's really expanding. Want to welcome all the new listeners. Also, it's important when you go to Infowars.com, we carry the best products I've found that I personally use, like eFoodsDirect.com/Alex, to get their best discounts on high-quality storable foods. In case this depression really gets bad, it's good to have that backup. It's important to go to the site and get the ProPure water filters discounted 15% off. We're extending that a few more days because it's been the most popular sale of that product we've ever had. It's the lowest price anywhere you're going to find it at InfoWarsStore.com. It also has the fluoride filters you can get as well. They have the Traveler unit, stainless steel, next to the competition. We'll go look at the side-by-side to its leading competitors. It is numero uno. It's what I use in my home and here at the office. So Pro Pure, available at InfoWarsStore.com. And we have the new survival film about safest areas in the country and even outside big cities, the safest sub-areas, like the Texas Hill Country outside Austin. Strategic Relocation with Joel Skousen, an incredible new film that we're now shipping. That is available at InfoWarsStore.com as well. Find all of Dr. Steve Pieczenik's great books and materials at stevepieczenik.com, supporting our guest as well. Okay, Doc, you got the floor. We got 15 minutes left in the segment now. I'm going to stand down here, roll through it in layman's terms. Benghazi, what this signifies, where it's now going, why these generals are all leaving, what this signifies, you know, shouldn't they be speaking out? We know they sat there while those people were murdered. Who was really behind that? Where is it all going? What do you predict?
Number one, the Benghazi episode has been the culmination of illegal operations that have been done under the CIA with Petraeus, first with Panetta, who was DCI, and basically the CIA is no longer the CIA we knew about 10, 20 years ago, where I had men who had worked for our country. They're basically mercenaries who have been hired out of special forces, have been using drone attacks and killing many, many people. Panetta is seriously should be impeached for war crimes. He was then brought into the military and really does not understand the military. He does not come from the military culture. the military did not accept Panetta's view of drone attacks. They have a much more sophisticated approach to the world. They're much more precise. They follow orders. Unfortunately, the military watched a series of attacks occurring in Benghazi with an illegal operation, legal meaning literally it was illegal, using the cover of a consulate, which is an illegal cover, to use torture of Libyan prisoners and foreign prisoners, which we were interrogating and repeatedly, and the CIA denied that, and was also supplying weapons into Syria in a misbegotten type of foreign policy, which was initiated by Hillary Clinton, Obama, Valerie Jarrett, and the people in the White House. So we've been running an incredible amount of secret wars under Obama, where normally we should have known about it. Our Congress has never covered it. And we have had more wars and covert operations under him than any other president I know of. And since he's come out of the CIA, he's run by the CIA. What you have here is a cultural clash between military generals who refuse to continue to listen to civilian authority. And I have encouraged that through my lectures at the war colleges, through my meetings with the generals, saying that at some point in time, you generals will have to stand up to civilian leaders who led us into the war in Vietnam, who led us into the wars in Iraq, who led us into Afghanistan. You have performed poorly. You have performed exceedingly poorly. You have destroyed the integrity of the military and the army. And yet, these generals watched while their own men were being killed and said nothing. Now, it's unfortunate. They should have said something. They should have stood forward. And instead, they were given the cover story by Dempsey, who's a total coward, someone I met, had total disrespect for, and Panetta, another coward who should be impeached and in the White House. And in turn, they were told to stand down. But what was happening in the middle of all of this Benghazi episode was the fact that not only was a Navy rear admiral and a carrier task force sent back, which is unheard of, and they were ready to protect our soldiers after 7 hours of an attack, and where these special forces units were literally putting their lives on the line to say, look, save us, and they were told that they would be saved, but they weren't. Basically, what happened is this was an attempt by the White House, by Panetta, by all the men in the CIA from the old days, like Brannon, who should have been indicted for war criminals under 9/11, 2001, who's a continuing problem. Donilon, who should have been indicted for criminal activities under 9/11. And this is all culmination where the military did not do what they should have done, which was to refuse a civilian order and be treasonous, as I have been repeatedly, and defy civilian order to save the lives of our military men. I'm ashamed of our military for having done that. I'm sorry that they did it. But basically what's happened is that there was a fear in the White House, and a correct fear, that part of what I had been doing and others had been doing was to develop a military corps of generals, which Petraeus was part of, say that we will no longer follow civilian orders, meaning that the civilians who've come to power, our president, Bush Jr., Clinton, and Obama, really know nothing about foreign policy. And the people who they picked, Susan Rice, Hillary Clinton, Samantha Powers, Brandon, all of these people are incompetent. They've had a history of incompetence, and they're an ideologue. And they basically wanted to go into countries like Libya and overthrow Gaddafi, who was our ally for years, and create stories that really were not even rational, and claim that we would create an Arab Spring when, in fact, they had no solution as to what that meant and where that was going. And in Benghazi, this was the final point of where the military and the civilians, or the CIA, came to a clash of who was in charge. And it was clear that at this point in time, the president committed not only a legal act that used the State Department as a cover for torture and extradition, as well as sending a weapon illegally into Syria on rebels where we had never declared war, but at the same time, it was the clash to allow the civilians to get rid of all those generals who in any way could be defying the White House. So this is really a coup attempt. This was the taking down of a real military coup to say, we've had enough. And unfortunately, our military backed down, and they will pay a heavy price for it. 14 other Navy commanders were dismissed during this period, and that was not written about. So that basically the White House, under the direction of Brennan, who was a very dangerous CIA operative who was involved in 9/11, should have been indicted for criminal activities under the 2001 9/11, Donlan as well, and this gets into that specific issue. Now, the person who's missing in all of this, and the most important person who's never been talked about, is exactly the person you were talking about. And that's Mr. Bob Mueller, who for years I have warned that if he doesn't watch what he's doing, he should be under investigation and should be the one who's being investigated. Mueller has had a very, very dangerous history of having come in before 9/11, 1 week beforehand, appointed by Bush Jr., the head of the FBI, and knew very well that his involvement in 9/11, the attack, the stand-down, and the false attack that we had, and basically he was covering that up with the FBI agents. There's no question about it.
And by the way, his number two, just to briefly interject, was saying that they were going to allow an al-Qaeda attack as a pretext. He even gave newspaper interviews, John O'Neill, and then he died in the World Trade Center, we're told.
Correct. And I knew about O'Neill because John O'Neill was the CIA operative who was sent to New York, and the head of counterintelligence of the CIA told me about him, and he warned about it. Mueller should be investigated, should be indicted for war crimes. He is very much a part of this cover-up and has been for a very long, long time. Mueller goes back, and so does the FBI, which should also be investigated. But unfortunately, we don't have investigative capabilities. Our Congress, our Senate is totally defunct. So we have to develop some kind of body where the American public comes in and says, you know what, our congressmen and senators are useless. Our civilians are useless. But Mueller has to be investigated repeatedly for his involvement, not only in 9/11, 2001, cover up the criminal activities, but now illegal operation against the military, the CIA, and it harks back to the time of J. Edgar Hoover, when he used the investigative powers of the FBI to illegally monitor not only President Nixon, which was an illegal monitor, by the way, but used illegal monitoring of every other political candidate and used that as a way to punish our military and our CIA. So the notion that the FBI has worked closely with the CIA or the military is fictitious as far as I'm concerned. For over 30 years, when I've worked with the FBI or the CIA, they have been the most least cooperative group I've ever seen. In particular, they also make up their own storylines, which is absolutely amazing. I was involved in the Hanafi Muslim, and they failed terribly. And I defied presidential order, and that was basically treason. I threw out the president of the United States, Jimmy Carter, and warned him that if he would have come back into the room, I would have 500 hostages killed as he started it. That was basically treason. At the same time, I committed treason when I overthrew someone in the Aldo Moro kidnapping, and that's what we call a hard coup. There was no question that I overrode the CIA, overrode military orders, overrode civilian orders. But in my opinion, and at the directive of whoever it was, in my own opinion, I was able to do that. And for those years, nobody could understand it. That's why I was able to override the CIA and either fire or dismiss them or marginalize them.
Well, now that you've told the Jimmy Carter story, I looked it up. It's on record that you were the State Department representative at the famous Camp David Accord. We should have you on just about the history sometime.
Correct. But let me get back to this story of why this...
But, I mean, let's get back to you. What happened with President Carter?
Well, Jimmy Carter, President Carter had initially created a... got himself involved in a bank holdup where he was micromanaging everything. And as a result of that, what happened was a man by the name Khalid, who saw his daughter drowned by the Elijah Muhammad group, held five different buildings hostages, including B'nai B'rith, shot Mayor Barry, and we had 500 hostages. The FBI could not handle it. The CIA could not handle it. And I was called in the middle of the night to take it over. And Earl Silbert, who was at that time not my friend, but was the U.S. Attorney General, I told him that whatever happens will be canceled. We'll have a gag order. No one is to talk. Nobody's to say anything. And I took over complete command and control. There were three ambassadors from Yaqub Khan, from Pakistan, from Egypt, and from Iran. all of whom were just sitting there. So I provided the Quran. I quickly formulated the strategy and tactics where I took over the control of Khalees and told them that this is what's going to happen. And through Cullinane, who was a very good police officer, we were able to change the entire course of the disastrous event where 500 people with napalm on the stairwells was about to die, and Jimmy Carter had no understanding of it, neither did his people. And I literally threw them out, and I warned them that if they didn't come in, they will have a bloodbath on their hands.
Sure, and that's on record, too. It sounds amazing
that's
to listeners.
This is not something
but let's expand on this. Let's expand on this, then. Sure. Where, I'm just letting people know the kind of stuff you've done and what you've seen. Where is this going now where mercenaries, because the U.S. has been corrupt for a long time, and that's part of the whole Machiavellian system. And, you know, when you dance with the devil, the devil doesn't change, you change. But now you can see it that what these mercenaries and the CIA and 80% of intelligence now run by private groups. I found an NSA base by my house and have confirmed it. Well, it's a private group, data mining. I mean, that's how bad it is. It's just everywhere now. They've made the American people their enemy, too, because that's a new battlefield for them. They don't care about long term. Now they really just want their paychecks. You've got contractors, low level, paid more than top generals. And so it's a private corporate coup that we see happening, and they brag about it. Where is it going then?
Well, it is going into a major confrontation with our military, because for every mercenary who's basically was either ex special forces receives $250,000, and you put in a special forces legal soldier next to him, and he's only making $40,000 or $50,000. You're going to get real conflicts. And I remember telling General Schumacher, the head of Special Forces and the head of the Army, 10 years ago, that our major enemy within 5 to 10 years, and it's right now about Benghazi, will be those mercenaries under L3, under Northrop Grumman, under all the companies that have been outsourced. And Panetta has been one of the greatest users of these L3 communications, as has the CIA.
By the way, they plan to use L3 domestically for civil unrest. They got a giant training base here in Texas. Stay there. I want to come back then and just zero in. Why did Obama stand down then if it was some type of internal operation with the neocons wanting to get missiles into the next theater to expand the war? Why did Obama play into their hands, or is he joined up with these people? I mean, I want to zero in on this. Okay, we got one more segment here and then another. Two more segments, short ones, with Dr. Steve Pieczenik. Riveting, powerful interview. Unfortunately, so much is what he's saying, I can just verify from open intelligence, reading between the lines here. I was saying, isn't it about phasing out the military, converting it to a social enforcement thing domestically, everything going to drones controlled by mega corporations that have hijacked our country? And he said, bingo, that's it. So, Dr. Pieczenik, you also had another announcement you wanted to make about the CFR. Break down geopolitically where all this is going, because soon the mercenaries are going to be cut out of the equation, too. The New World Order, it likes robots. It likes drones. It likes drone subs and drone ships. Explain where we're going.
Basically, this is the end of the army. We no longer really need an army. It will be decreased in size. They know this. This is the end. We don't need army units. We don't need the teeth-to-tail ratio. In other words, the amount of supply that we need to get actual fighters in, who have not done well, is very high. So basically, where we are going into is a new kind of warfare, which is space warfare, cyber war, and cyber attack, which is really very important. Does it belong to the army? It really now belongs to a whole new concept, which the United States has to begin to understand, which has to deal with private industry and working in cyber war and cyber security. Because the Army isn't necessarily designated or has been trained in cyber war and cyber attack. Although they're interested in it, it's not the sine qua non of their reason. So what you have is the elimination of really war structures that can effectively change the world powers. What can change world powers is now social media, statements like what you make, what we do. The CFRs are finished. I quit, as I told you. I resigned. It was an antiquated rest home for, very, you know, retarded individuals who are just...
But you got to get in Dempsey's face there. It's still useful for that.
Yeah, well, but Dempsey is a coward. I mean, if I were what I normally was, George Marshall, I would have fired him on spot. I would have fired 600 generals on spot. We don't do that anymore. Instead, we promote the generals. We give them pensions for $3 million. So they're useless.
Sure. Bottom line, where's it going with Obama then? How bad
Obama
is this?
Obama is going to be heading into a very serious problem of impeachment. If he continues all these wars that are illegal wars, which have not been overseen by the Congress and the most effective Congress, but the American public understands that this is not just the president who quietly goes around and does what he does. He has been ordering these covert operations for years on end and is a product of the CIA and can no longer continue this. We will implode in terms of both our national security and also our military will refuse to follow any more orders. And in particular, I talk about our Air Force, which is in space warfare, which has to do with satellite warfare, and our Navy. Because our Navy, when you talk about our Navy, nobody's really talked about our nuclear subs and our fleets, what we call SINCPAC, Commander of the Pacific.
Or the nuclear drone subs. They have those classified missile platforms that have been around for 20 years.
Right. So some kind of deterrence is required. Are we going to be going into another major war? No. But we have created under Obama and the Bush administration more unnecessary wars thanks to the CIA, thanks to incompetent civilians and incompetent generals who wanted to just get their...
Back in 60 seconds, Doc. Wow, we were just talking about space-based weapons and how advanced they really are with Dr. Pieczenik. Okay, we got 5 minutes, Doc, and Larry Pratt's coming up, folks, on the assault on the Second Amendment. Government is getting more and more corrupt, more and more out of control. Look at the Secret Service and the hookers, all of it. They've got all these super weapons, but they're starting all these wars. They're trying to convert America to the police state. What's the establishment's grand plan, and is there any way to turn it around in your view, Dr. Pieczenik?
Yes, I think it's very easy that the American public now yesterday started requiring that states' rights, that they wanted to secede from the Union. I think this is something I wrote about 10, 20 years ago in State of Emergency, that the federal government has lost its legitimacy across the board on the civilian side, legislative, executive, judicial, on the military and the intelligence side. It is no longer a legitimate body of our republic. It has become a serious problem to our republic and the sustaining of the ability of the republic to remain. So therefore, the question becomes, does the republic really have legitimacy? And the answer is no. The federal government has lost its legitimacy, and I think those who are requiring and asking for states' rights, I think, are right. I wrote about it in the State of Emergency when I said state after state will fight over water resources, and that from now on, our country has to be concerned about domestic issues, taking care of our veterans, taking care of people's jobs, making sure that we grow domestically and not fund some military-industrial complex that General Eisenhower, one of our greatest generals, said we no longer need, is dangerous, and at the same time warned the CIA that they would create a legacy of ashes. His words have come back to resonate 40, 50 years later. We have to decrease and eliminate most of our military across the board, just as George Marshall did, when he fired 600 to 700 generals in one day. Eisenhower kept firing them until young men who were 26 and 27 were division commanders. We don't need an army anymore. We have space warfare. We have cyber war. We don't need that. And the notion that we really need is the greatest national security problem we have is our national debt. And the greatest problem in our national debt is that we're not really developing our own economic strength and force. And in doing that, we have to now get rid of those people who have committed the crimes against the state. Number one is Mueller. I think Mueller should be brought forth more than anybody else and investigated for what he has been investigating. Number two is the CIA, and they should be eliminated completely. Number three, the generals, about 300 to 400 should be dismissed right away and taken down to the simplest core of special forces. Number four, I think everybody involved in this Benghazi attack, from Hillary Clinton, should be indicted for war crime. The president should be possibly impeached. Every one of the men in the White House, Donlan, Brannon, particularly, should be impeached and indicted, and as well as the Clapper and the DNI, which is totally useless. And General Dempsey should be court-martialed. That's my opinion. I think that's what's going to happen. I think the American public is sick and tired of corruption, of excuses, of lies. And throughout the world, we have been the only country that has lived through those lies and have been able to break through them. The American public is not stupid, and they will not tolerate that. But the lies of 9/11 have come back of 2001 to recapitulate again the lies of Benghazi of 9/11. Congress needs to wake up, but it represents nothing. Congress is now a dead body, has very little legitimacy. The White House has very little legitimacy.
And so all we have is giant organized crime syndicates battling for taxpayer money. And that's why they want to keep raising taxes to get more corporate welfare. And they plan on using the giant welfare hordes as the political muscle to vote the middle class's money directly into the bankers' hands while the dumbed-down welfare queens drool, demanding more goodies.
I think it goes back to the original statement I made 10 years ago on your first show, which said we needed a revolution. Revolution doesn't have to be violent. It has to be one which takes down the totally corrupt White House, totally corrupt Congress, totally corrupt judicial system, totally corrupt FBI, Secret Service is totally corrupt.
It's time to restore the Republic. Dr. Pieczenik, let me say bye to you during the break. Thank you so much, SteveFieczenik.com. Thank you. I'm Alex Jones of InfoWars.com. Welcome to another live hour of the Alex Jones Show. And I think you guessed it, I am Alex Jones. I know we've got a lot of new listeners tuning in every day as the broadcast continues to explode. Well, the bugle has sounded. The charge has begun. Obama is not facing re-election. He has the power of the executive order. He has shown he'll use it like no other president. And he, as a state senator and U.S. senator, we did this in a report last week, read the quotes from the voter guides there in Illinois. He said he believes in the abolition of private ownership. He believes in a total ban of guns. You see Chicago, total ban. You see New York, total ban for the general public. If you're kind of the mafia-connected bigwigs, they can get, you know, armed guards or whatever. You know, the mercenaries, they're always allowed to have their guns. The UN's above the law. They can rape and kill whoever they want, get diplomatic immunity in any city. So that's what it's all about. The government massing weaponry against us, private mercenaries, but we can't have anything. And Obama has said he wants the assault weapons ban back. And Dianne Feinstein, as you know, has said that means physical. She wants California-style where you have to turn them in. She wants gun shows shut down. Again, I did a 20-minute special report last week titled, you know, Proof Obama is Coming for Your Guns. But I thought we should get Larry Pratt on for about 40 minutes or so, and then we'll go to your phone calls, those of you that are holding, and get into some of the economic news that I have not gotten into yet in any detail that we need to cover. But, I mean, this is just from last year and again this year, ATF to accept public comments prior to outlawing shotguns. And then you go, they have a link in the Greeley Gazette, this should have been national news, to the ATF, and they said, oh, we're going to have a rulemaking saying we're going to ban most shotguns, 60-plus percent made in the last decade, that can take a clip, that can be converted to take a clip. Well, that's any gun that is semi-auto or pump that you load in the bottom. That's pretty much all my shotguns. So it's not just law. They're suing gun manufacturers, Bloomberg, who also wants to tell you what you could eat and drink. These are control freaks. They want us to live like folks in Chicago and New York with 6-7 locks on our doors, the great people in New York and Chicago, not allowed to defend themselves. This is mafia government. We're on the air, by the way, in Chicago. We've had folks call in saying they wish they could have guns. Almost impossible to get one. And they harass people statewide there. But those cities is where they really restrict it. California, highly restrictive. And if you look at a map of the world, most countries have banned guns outright. And they always follow the same pattern. So the plunge is happening now. And I know Larry Platt doesn't like to be alarmist, but what did Barry Goldwater say? Extremism in defense of liberty is no vice. So I really want him, pun intended, to hit him with both barrels, gunowners.org. He's the executive director of Gun Owners of America for over 30 years, needs no introduction. And again, the NRA's gotten better. I remember talking to Larry 12 years ago and saying, you've got to go after the NRA for their 68 Gun Control Act support, for their current support. And he finally started going after them a few years ago when they were basically saying, oh, we can have some, you know, restriction. They've gotten a little better, but still gun owners is the place to keep the NRA honest. So all I can say is go sign up, become a member, I get the free email alerts, gunowners.org, because we would have our guns basically banned if it wasn't for Gun Owners of America and you supporting them and many others. And it's just a fact. Understand, folks, we don't have a lot of allies, but the ones we've got are like big junkyard dogs in defense of the Republic. Larry, how bad is it? Because we know the former chief of staff at the White House said we're going to put you on a no-gun buy list. We know they're moving towards that. I mean, they are licking their chops right now. Obama said in the second debate that he wants to ban not just semi-auto rifles, but handguns. So they're letting us know the UN is reconvened. They're letting us know that UN goal of, quote, banning civilian ownership of firearms, saying they threaten the legitimate power monopoly of the state. That's July 7th, 2001, UNIDIR. I mean, how bad is it? What is the state of our precious Second Amendment, the only country really in the world left other than Switzerland that doesn't have disarmed slaves?
Well, Alex, first of all, thank you so much for letting me appear before your viewers and listeners. You have a tremendous audience, and I'm very grateful every time I have a chance to visit with you. I don't think your concerns are misplaced. I think this president showed us during the time when he still had to face re-election that he didn't have any basic problems, certainly no moral objection, to ruling illegally and to ruling unconstitutionally. And his use of the executive order is something like perhaps 10 times what George Bush's was, and his was quite a bit more than those before him. So we have seen government growing like a metastatic cancer here in Washington and its enclaves all around the country, and I suppose around the world. It's just stunning to me that we have reelected a man who really doesn't give a rip about his oath of office. Whatever he understands by the Constitution isn't what the founders understood. And so I think we're in for, as you're indicating, a real tough time. I would have no surprise if the president were to have his Department of Justice issue an edict to gun stores who were ultimately under them through the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, which is part of the Department of Justice, telling the dealers, you'll lose your license after, oh, maybe 30 days from now, if you sell another handgun that has a caliber bigger than 380, or if you sell a long gun, rifle or shotgun, that accepts a high-capacity magazine. And as you indicated, that's probably most of your shotguns. And any rifles you might have might also fit that same description. It's going to hit, if he were to do something like that, in a way that the dealers would have no choice, because unconstitutionally, they have to have it right now. They have to have a permit, a license from the federales in order to be able to open a business and stay in business. And the day they pull that license from any dealer, he's out of business. He can no longer sell any of his guns to the general public. He's finished. And so if your livelihood depends on that unconstitutional scrap of paper, well, you're going to tend to do whatever you're told from Washington or else. And so I can see something like that happening. And by the way, it would probably make the UN so happy, because in countries where they do let you have a gun, my wife's from Panama, and their laws are rather similar to those of Latin America. If you can crawl over enough glass and you have enough connections and you finally get a permit, you'll be limited to a 380, and you won't be able to have any long gun that accepts a high-capacity magazine. So that would make us so much more responsible in the eyes of the rest of the world. You know that will be one of the arguments that, well, our good friends, if we're going to be a responsible citizen in the world community, these are the kinds of conditions that we will have to impose upon ourselves in order to be a good neighbor in the international community. Barf. I'm afraid that's what's coming down. And there's two ways that I think we can try to deal with this. One is that there are a small number of representatives coming to the Congress, the likes of which there have never been in my memory. maybe if I go back to John Ashbrook, somebody like that was a very outspoken conservative and died mysteriously in a Senate campaign years and years ago. But for the recent past, we've had nobody like Steve Stockman, who just got elected from a district outside of Houston to the east and to the north, and Jackie Walorski in the northwest corner of Indiana. These two have a history that tells me, and since I know them personally, I'll just describe them, but I understand there may be a handful of others coming with the same steel backbone that these two have. When Stockman was in Congress for his one term with the class of 94, he introduced a bill to overturn the recently enacted Clinton gun ban. And the Republicans were even more, if you will, gun-shy than they are now. This was a controversial issue. They didn't want to touch
it. I get where you're going. It's time to get on the offense or we're cooked. It's over. We either realize we either gain ground or we're going to lose it all. This is a war. We cannot just keep having battles. We have to literally go dig these people out. We have to call them the authoritarian scum they are, because listen, the gun culture is the reason they call us bitter clingers is they know it's the core. It's what brings everybody together. Even liberals I know on social issues get now that they need guns, and we're gaining ground on this. So they're coming in to take it all. The final battle is starting to really unfold.
I think so. I think we're going to see the fangs bared by this administration again. No more elections that he has to worry about, and I don't think he worries about his party. I don't think he worries about anything.
Finish your point about himself. The people and bringing bills up. Is that what you were getting at? Is it time to go on the offense?
It's time to go on the offense. It's time to reintroduce and to push all over again repealers that repeal whole swaths of unconstitutional federal gun laws. Stockman did it against his Republican leadership when he was in. We were in a meeting in Dick Armey's office. He was the majority leader then, and he told us to our face, you're not going to get a vote on Stockman's bill. If you do, it'll be over my dead body. Well, Gingrich was a little politically moxier. We did get the vote because Gingrich didn't want Gun Owners of America messing over his guys in their districts over this issue.
That's right. We've got to really just remove the rhinos, put real people in there. I want to come back and get into what I'm now seeing on the news. They're saying it's racist to own guns. Kind of like if you don't want government-run health care, you're racist. And Obama's now being called the conqueror. I mean, this is some really scary nomenclature we're hearing. Stay with us. Gentlemen, it's on. Obama said in the second debate that he didn't want to just ban semi-automatic rifles. He wants to ban your handguns that are semi-automatic. That's most handguns. And they've got the UN treaty coming up that once it's passed, the member nations, 50% vote, 51%, it becomes law here. They've got more Democrats in the Senate. And we're in deep trouble. I mean, we've never had the Second Amendment hanging by a thread. And they try to play this double game of going, we don't want your guns. You're stupid to go out and buy them, even though every gun I've bought over the last 20-something years has gone up in price. It's amazing. And they really can't stand the fact that we know they're liars and we're voting with our dollars. And the fact that our gun culture, I just showed the Huffington Post article there in the last segment if you're watching on PrisonPlanet.tv, but it says Obama's got to do something about this growing gun culture. They are hitting the panic button. Will you guys pull that back up? That was a great article you found. They are panicking. No, not that article about General Petraeus, but that one, yeah. Obama must take drastic action to end gun culture, to end our culture. See, the media has destroyed our culture. They've destroyed Christianity. They've destroyed everything. We don't have anything left, hardly, but guns. I hate to say that, but that's the one thing people still get. I'm not a slave. I have a right to defend myself. Places that take the guns have higher crime. Larry Pratt, I mean, is that an overstatement that at so many levels, the strongest thing we've got at so many areas is the guns, and they know it, and they are launching a total assault on it. A, do you agree? B, what do we do to defeat them? I mean, I agree with you. Go on the offense.
Well, in addition to going on the offense, and I think now we have some players who are willing to play offense. I mentioned two of them, Steve Stockman, a new representative in the House of Representatives here in Washington, and Jackie Walorski, also a new representative. They have a history of standing up to their party leaders, elected leaders. In Jackie Walorski's case, she bucked Governor Mitch Daniels, who is known as a fiscal conservative. Well, he wanted to raise taxes to balance the budget, and she bucked him and got the whole caucus eventually to go along with her, forcing him to make cuts instead of raising taxes. Now, in a way, that's almost, it's at least as impressive as what Stockman did, because Stockman got his vote on the gun issue. And unlike the last time, if it goes over to the Senate, it's not going to be smothered by a Bob Dole. And Harry Reid has shown that when push comes to shove, he's a little reluctant to have an up or down vote on a gun issue. And so what I think might well happen is we'll get something out of the House. It'll go over to the Senate. Reid won't want to bring it up. But the rules of the Senate are rather somewhat more available for getting things done. And as an amendment, on threat of a filibuster, I can see somebody like Jim DeMint, Mike Lee, Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, somebody of that sort, making sure that there's a fight to amend, a spending bill that the president has shown in the past he will sign even with pro-gun amendments to it. And that way we could actually have the prospect of getting something done.
Sure. So it's time to get on the offense. Briefly, we're going to come back with part of the next segment and then let you go, because I know you're a busy man. Oh, you had one more point?
No, we can break if you need to. That's fine.
No. I was just going to say, shifting gears, another subject, because I mentioned it before the break. We are seeing, and I'm getting callers saying this, when I'm defending the Second Amendment, saying you're just a racist. And I go, what does that mean? And they can't even say, and now I'm seeing MSNBC and people say, aha, the age of the white man's over. You're going to have to turn your guns in. And I'm getting emails and seeing comments on YouTube. This is some new meme, it's like a weird reverse racism or something. And the cover of Newsweek says, you're white, your history, the Obama conquest, and he's in a Napoleon outfit with a sword. It's like some on the left now just are screaming for authoritarianism, but it's almost like Hitlerian, though, because it's mixed with a weird racial vitriol that I guess MSNBC's been able to sell. It's very bizarre.
Yeah, they've learned that many conservatives, or at least many, quote, Republicans, are cowed by the playing of the race card. And I think what we need to do is to, if we're, I speak Spanish, I address Spanish audiences, I did a debate for an hour on CNN in Espanol, and the point has to be made that the fact that guns are readily available here is why America is different. It's the tangible expression of the American spirit that we the people are in charge, not the governments from which you fled to get here to America.
I want to hear you break that down further when we come back, because it's fundamental that if they can get our guns, they believe they've won. I mean, because then it's about living under the socialists. They're going to take everything we got. I mean, this is slavery. Hitler took the guns. Stalin took the guns. Lenin, Mao. Mao Zedong said political power grows out of the barrel of a gun. The big government people don't like the fact we've got the guns. We'll be right back.
Defending the Republic from enemies, foreign and domestic. It's Alex Jones.
Okay, Mark Faber, I tell you, he's been incredibly accurate predicting things. He says prepare for massive market meltdown. We're going to get to that and then some of your phone calls when Larry Pratt leaves us. Larry, I've been asking a lot of the questions here. I want you to be able to add any other points that you think are important for listeners and other assaults we're going to see. But they tell us they're coming after our guns. They go, you got a Second Amendment. We just have a right to take them. But finishing up the point that you were trying to get to, because they say, it's racist that our guns are killing people in Mexico. Well, Mexico's banned guns, and most of the guys that have them, it's hand grenades and grenade launchers and machine guns. They're not getting those at gun stores. You know, it's turned out the ATF was shipping them directly into Mexico. Fast and Furious goes a lot deeper. But finishing up, with this weird racial vitriol where Time Magazine says you're white, your history, and shows Obama as a general with a sword. I mean, that's pretty, they show him as a dictator. They also show him as Lincoln and say he may have to deal with the states. We have Texas now in less than 24 hours. What is it, 50-something thousand signatures now? It was 25,000 in hours saying we want to secede. We need to just kick the globalist out of this country and just take our country back. But, I mean, where do you see Obama going? And, again, you were trying to finish your point about this whole racism angle. It's like, hey, I don't like lemon pie. Why are you racist? You know, it's like, hey, I don't like your food at this restaurant. What are you, racist? It's just this, and people call in like it's powerful. Like, they're going to say, why are you a racist when I'm talking about not wanting to shut down our coal power plants? And I go, well, what do you mean I'm racist? Well, you know you are. You don't like Obama. And I go, yeah, I don't like him. He's a front man for the globalist. I mean, it's like a religion now. I mean, what can you say to this? You were getting cut off by the break talking about your CNN debate.
Well, I think it's somewhat disappointing for the other side to realize that there are a number of us on the right who I'm married to a Latin American woman, have been for almost 50 years. And I can debate them in Spanish. And so that kind of takes a little bit of the starch out of their shirt, I think, because it doesn't fit the stereotype that somebody that they just assume, if you don't agree with me, as you were saying, Alex, it's one size fits all. Well, you're a racist. I mean, if you don't agree with me down the line, everything I say, you're a racist. They don't increasingly have the ability to debate their point. And when I did the CNN debate in Spanish, they felt, I guess they were comfortable with the strength in numbers, so it was 3-1. But, you know, it's all the same argument, so I was really only debating one other, that argument that they all three were making. And they don't, I'm not sure they figured out how to get out of that pit. Now, so far, they were able to do a very effective job with Mitt Romney, because Mitt Romney, who doesn't share, say, a Reagan view of America's greatness, and he doesn't know how to articulate it, that's for sure, and he didn't. And so he let Obama get away with anything he wanted. And in fact, as you say, they came up with the race card in the Fast and Furious scandal. Wait, excuse me? Those are Mexicans that are dying, almost none of whom trace back to Spain through my wife's lineage. These are people who are brown, who are typical Latin Americans. And I thought it was kind of racist to kill some 400 plus and counting with guns that our government sent down there for that purpose.
But I mean,
and why isn't that racist?
Sure. I mean, you're right. But I mean, it's literally, like you said, you go, hey, I don't want socialism. I don't want to lose our freedoms. And they just call in and go, you're a racist.
Right.
And then they wait like you're about to fall over. Right. And I guess and they repeat talking points of MSNBC and Chris Matthews and Rachel Maddow and all of them. I mean, they get up there and they say, if you don't like health care, it's because you're racist. I know government's going to ruin health care. And look, the prices are already going up. The economy's shutting down. I mean, socialism. I had a guy call in, who said he was a socialist. And when I said, well, I don't like socialism, he's endorsed communism before. His name is John from Ohio. He's called many times. He's a white guy. And when I said, look, socialism doesn't work, he goes, well, that's a typical racist statement. And I'm like, I mean, the Russians are white. It didn't work over there. I mean, you know, there's hardly any black people over there, maybe, you know, 1 out of 1,000. What is that now, racist too? I mean, it's like, if I say I like lemon pie over cheesecake, they go, that's racist. I mean, it's like if I say I like blue skies instead of, red skies. It's like if I have all they say is that. It's like a weird cult of people just like parrots. Racism, racism, right? It's really bizarre. Racism, racism, racism.
Some of the folks that have been produced by the public schools, the government schools, are probably okay with that comeback, that's racist. But frankly, a lot of people in this country still can think. And if that's the way they want to conduct a debate in front of the American people, bring it on. I think it's time we have that debate and let the whole country see just how inadequate their arguments
are. But why would Newsweek come out and have David Frum has attacked me 7 ways to Sunday come out and say, if you're white, your history. I mean, that is an, and then I see that as a meme online. It's like trying to, I guess they want, the left really wants to try to have a race war in the hopper.
Well, golly, you're going to have to be attacked by somebody at more substance than Newsweek. They're no longer publishing in paper. They're only online. What the American people are not buying that stuff. And if that little kept house conservative, Mr. Fromm, is happy associating with Newsweek, bless his heart, more power to him.
You're right. He is just a piece of work. What do you think this election really signified? I mean, I saw a lot of fraud against Romney. I just call it like I see it. Some states didn't even count that day's votes and just said he, you know, that Obama was the winner. I see them saying conservatives and libertarians had better become socialists if you ever want to win the Democrats. Well, I mean, if you became Stalin, they would become Lenin. If you became Lenin, they would become Marx. There's no way to ever become them to win because you've already become them. You've got to go out and promote real constitutionalism. We saw 12 million to 15 million Ron Paul people go out and not vote this time because of the way they were treated. And in a way, some say, let it get worse. That's what will cause real change. I mean, is there a way to make lemons out of this lemonade?
Well, I'd prefer to make lemons that I purchased rather than that were shoved down my throat.
Sure.
But I'll do what I have to do. And so in addition to going on the offense in Congress, which I think now we might be able to do, we also need to keep in mind, and you and I have talked about this before, there is an most of our states, the very powerful institution of the county sheriff. In fact, one of the things I'd urge people to buy at our site at gunowners.org in the media section where we have the bookstore, or one other site, you'll find the bookstore. It's called The County Sheriff by Richard Mack. You've probably interviewed him.
Excellent book. We carry it as well. People should go to gunowners.org and buy that book and give it to your sheriff and give it to all the sheriff candidates.
Yes, that's exactly. Read it first so you're sure you know what's in it. But it's the history and the constitutional doctrine of the sheriff as the top cop because he's the only cop that has an immediate delegation of authority via election from we the people, by we the people. And so it is very important that we increase the number of these constitutional sheriffs throughout the land who are willing and able to tell the feds, not in my county. If what you're trying to do is not in Article 1, Section 8 of our federal constitution, and there's a couple other things the constitution tells them to do as well, then you're not going to do it here in this county.
And the sheriff gets their authority from the state constitutions. Expanding on that, what do you make of nullification? I think that's something we're going to really see explode now.
The sheriff is the guy who can nullify. A state legislature can nullify enacting legislation that's, and some states have done it, saying there's not going to be any exchange for Obamacare in our state. They are just flat out telling the feds, take a hike. That's what the federal system was designed to do. And now with 25 states, I think is the latest count, petitioning the White House for secession. And it's a rather more serious matter than any of the other states when Texas does that, because Texas came into the union with the proviso, explicit proviso, that it can also say adios and it can be on its way.
And that's why it's called the Lone Star State, because it has that proviso built in. Go ahead.
So I think that's a very serious threat. Texas is one of the few healthy economies in this among the states of this country. It's robust. It has a conservative political culture. And frankly, I think there could be a majority of Texans that say, you know, why not? We've got our own sea coast. If they can't really boycott our airports because we have too many hubs that are central for the airlines. We're just too important for them to ignore. Do they really think they're going to invade Texas and take it over? You know, they tried that once, and they got away with it that one time. I don't think they'd get away with it this time. I don't think the military most of them would say, that's not a constitutional order. I'm not going to do it.
Well, the Texas legislature last year said, you're not going to grope us anymore because all of the House reps have been flying into Austin had been getting groped. Unanimous House vote. Dewhurst killed it in the Senate, so he lost his national Senate run. Cruz says he's going to support the Second Amendment, a Ron Paul type guy. We'll see if that's really the case. But expanding on all of this, they threatened a federal blockade with aircraft. I say, throw me in that briar patch. Let's get this confrontation going. Let's show what crooks you are.
Right. I don't. I think that blockade would hurt the remaining states more than it would hurt Texas, and it could well precipitate a sympathetic joining of Texas's action.
You know it's going to happen. We need Texas to lead out of this New World Order takeover, and then we can reconstitute the republic, because there's no doubt, Larry, we've got a globalist takeover in Washington. They think they've conquered this country. They brag on the news that these foreign banks have taken us over. They're the ones that want us disarmed so that they can create socialism to suck our money offshore to themselves. And they want to use a giant gaggle of illegals and welfare queens as their army. And I just, it's time to call them on it. It's time to get in their face.
Texas could effectively seal its own border. That would be an extremely positive first step, whether or not they ultimately secede, to simply say, we're being invaded. United States, you're supposed to protect us from invasion. You're not. We're going to take that over because we didn't give that power away. We just said that was something the federal government should do. But if you're not going to do it, we're going to do it. And what are the feds going to do? Invade Texas in order to not close the border? I think at some point the American people are going to say, what? One of the biggest problem I saw with Romney is he, as a liberal, would not join issues, and he would not call Obama the socialist that he is. He would not specifically draw attention to the many socialist programs that Obama has been implementing and advocating, and he would not address the country in terms of the greatness of America, what it has been and what it can be again. He didn't spell any of that out.
Sure, because he couldn't. He agreed with Obama on so much. Right. And instead of, again, people going and joining the globalist, this is a real shot across the bow of the Republicans that no more games. They're not co-opting the liberty movement. It's over. They're either going to disappear and let the Democrats take over and a bunch of states are going to secede, or the power structure is going to get it.
Right. They're either going to have to act like Republicans talk. In other words, they're going to have to walk the talk. Or I agree with you. There will be, at first, I think we might see next election an increase in what we saw this time. The establishment continue to lose in contests that are brought by conservatives. The one in your Texas Senate race was a great example of an outsider challenging the establishment, Dewhurst. And Dewhurst showed what the establishment was like. He's a facilitator of all that is wrong in Texas. He makes it happen or keeps reform from happening as a lieutenant governor there in Texas.
Exactly.
He had a terrible record, and Cruz called him on it, showed how you should run a campaign. And when people hear that there is a distinction being drawn by somebody who really believes in freedom, the freedom fighter is often going to win.
Well said. There's no doubt Ron Paul would have beaten Obama, but the Republicans had to throw him out of there. And so now look what they've gotten. Larry Pratt, by the way, we were at gunowners.org. I've never seen this happen before. We crashed your site, buddy.
Gee, thanks a lot, Alex.
All right,
we'll have it back up shortly.
Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, and everybody should go there and sign up for the free email alerts. Thank you so much, Larry Pratt.
God bless you, my friend. Thanks.
There he goes. He's going off to another interview in 15 minutes. All right, I said I'd take some phone calls. I've got the economic news I need to hit. Is Trent ready in Illinois? Because we'll go to a call right now. All I can say is there's a lot of breaking news at Infowars.com. Right now, FEMA is now telling people in New York and New Jersey not to bring food to people, that only they're allowed to do it. Stocks tumble as Congressman predicts economic riots in America. Kurt Nimmo, U.S.-Canada integrated cybersecurity agenda. Why Obama wants your guns and the rest of your freedoms. What an incredibly important raft of articles. Don Salazar, citizens from 34 states petition White House to secede from the U.S. Another big article there. San Diego residents face 6 years in prison for washing their own cars. It actually says that the local news, and they're saying, yes, You wash your car, we're going to arrest you. If your dog poops, $100,000 fine. Notice they're doing gun confiscation drills in Arizona saying, well, because some people leave cartridges in the desert. Oh, so everybody's a slave now. It's like the Soviet model. Somebody does something wrong in this town, we'll randomly line 10 of the townspeople up and shoot them. That's how the authoritarians work. Somebody leaves a cartridge in the desert, all your guns must be turned in. We're running checkpoints. Wow. Let's jam in a call right now. Trent in Illinois, you're on the air. Go ahead.
How you doing, Alex?
Good.
I want to start off by saying I do not support Obama, and I do not support the actions that he is undergoing with the country at the moment. But my real question I want to get your take on, when are we going to see Denver Airport come into play? From the research that I've done, is that it's going to be the base for the globalist elite to survive while they're just destroying everything.
Yeah, I mean, it's official that Colorado is the designated secondary capital. It's got a bunch of underground bases in Colorado Springs. They're at NORAD and all over Denver. There's a bunch of underground stuff there at Denver. That's just the globalists digging in case they have a nuclear war with China or Russia. And they have the COG government operating there. The Congress is all vestigial. Unless Congress stands up and retakes its power. So, yeah, that's my take on that, on the Denver airport, sir.
So you think that we're going to be seeing a lot more action with it coming here shortly?
No. We already have a NORTHCOM military over the U.S. We already have Space Command based there. The real government is based there. That's why there's more underground bunkers and underground railways and missile bases you can shake a stick at. That's the head of NORTHCOM. That's the head of the military-industrial complex. It's run by foreign banks. That's the real capital. The whorehouse on the Potomac, D.C., is just the crime syndicate minions that are there as a facade of a vestigial ceremonial crust. What you need to do, no matter what race, color, creed, religion you are, is get self-sufficient. And realize that, hey, we can all kill each other later if you want, if that's what you want to do. But we need to understand the globalists are taking over our world. It's a scientific takeover, and it's anti-human, it's anti-God, and we better come together against the New World Order. You know in your gut it's true. You know intellectually it's true. And it's time for moron mainline conservatives to stop thinking they're part of the elite. It's time for liberals to start waking up and not thinking they're part of the elite. It's time to realize we're all in deep trouble and humble ourselves. Look at some of these headlines. Syrian opposition says West has promised military aid. More arms to Al-Qaeda. 6,125 proposed regulations and notifications posted in the last 90 days. The feds post it and let you comment and ram it forward. Like the Federal Reserve under Frank Dodd has its new enforcers over any business where they can just take things over. Private Federal Reserve is becoming a government agency openly. So in a way, you can say it's government, but unaccountable. A private government of pirates. It's now up to 34 states petitioning. It was just a few dozen last night, an additional 10 or so now, to secede. Again, Don Salazar, Infowars.com. Mark Faber, prepare for massive market meltdown, and that's out of CNBC. But get ready here. They've had members of Congress come out and say things are going to implode. Stocks tumble as congressman predicts economic riots in America. Louisiana Republican warns day of reckoning rapidly approaching. And the government will play the part of the savior and say, give me VAT, give me carbon tax, and that's in the news, and that new money will keep the welfare checks going. Now, it won't matter that 90% of that money will go to foreign banks, as long as they say, we're going to give it to the poor people, and they'll still get their check in devalued dollars and won't be able to buy as much, but that'll be okay. And I'll get to hear all day how it's evil and how I want the poor to starve if I don't want this. There's a reason the mega rich want this. It's called a takeover. Here's one. Board of Governors of Federal Reserve System. Agencies issue statement on supervisory practices regarding financial institutions and borrowers affected by Hurricane Sandy. The Federal Reserve now regulates. Can the Federal Reserve help prevent a second recession? Oh, they're saving us. Is the Federal Reserve using money laundering techniques to cleanse banks' balance sheets? Well, of course, it's a narcotics trafficking operation. That's Forbes. And it goes on and on and on and on. Very important articles. And the most important of the day just came out by Paul Watson. I want it red-linked. Why Obama wants your guns and the rest of your freedoms. Second Amendment in the crosshairs. They're coming. And we've got them from every hill and mountain, like Paul Revere announced. The New World Order is here. They're coming. We're under attack. InfoWar!
Thank you for listening to GCN. Visit GCNlive.com today.